who is Executive Secretary of the NCPC, that's the National Christian Pilgrims Commission. Thanks for being with us tonight.
Appreciate it, Toba. Good evening.
All right. Mm-hmm. We're also joined tonight by Reverend Israel Akonji, who is Chairman, Christian Association of Nigeria, FCT. Reverend Akonji.
Nice. Thank you.
Let me also welcome tonight Reverend Sam Ogbodo, who is Senior Pastor, King's Palace Church International, Kuji. Thanks for being here.
Good evening, Sister Toba.
And then we're joined tonight by Mr. Sunday Ude, Head Mobilization, NCPC. Thanks for being here.
Good evening, Stephen.
Okay.
And good evening, viewers.
Right, as we always do, we acquaint you with the process of this program. At the appropriate time, you can get to be part of the discussion. The platforms will be on your screens, and you can take advantage of that. And however, as we always say every Tuesday, when your call gets through at the appropriate time, do us a favor, just reduce the volume of your TV set so we can avoid the hurlback. And the process is simple. Once you call in, if your call is taken, it gets through, your name will appear on the screen. And once you see your name on screen, it means your call has been passed through. And that means you can go ahead with a question or comment. We advise that you just go straight to the point, keep it short, and not to bother too much about the greetings. You'll know how erratic the lines can be. So if you get through, take advantage of that and make your point quickly. And I guess we'll respond to such issues as you might raise. So once again, thanks for being with us on NT Tuesday Live. Let's begin by looking at the state of preparedness for the 2016 Christian Pilgrimage. And for that, let's turn to the Executive Secretary, Reverend Uja To Uja.
Thank you. Every stage has been set for 2016 Christian Pilgrimage. And we've done all the necessary backgrounds. We've raised the security committees and done the relevant holistic training for them, and the security is multifaceted. Some are known, majority are not known. We have raised the medical personnel in their categories who have been also been trained. We have also made the relevant agreements and signed the contracts with the air carriers who are going to flag, or rather fly, the pilgrims to their destinations. We have equally held meetings and conferences with the ground handlers. Ground handlers are those that manage the pilgrims in groups, in batches. Mm-hmm. When people get on pilgrimage, you are broken up into groups of, say, 50, and 50 in every bus. And the people who manage the movement are the ground handlers. And we have gone ahead to visit those places to reorganize the sites, So as to make sure that pilgrims are taken to relevant sites and they are taken up in proper programs. And we've done the process of visa procurement, we've done the screenings, and we've done all the necessary work. All that is left now is a flag off, which comes up on Thursday in Yola.
Okay, and we're looking at some 20,000 pilgrims who are going to be doing this.
Yes.
What's the span of this exercise this time around?
Normally, we're going to end it by the end of December because we cannot cross over into the following year. Mm-hmm. We actually suffered a delay because throughout October, the Israelis were on holidays. So they couldn't work on any visas at all. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we would have started before the end of October. Mm-hmm. But now that they are there, they've started sending the visas, we'll flag off. And normally, we'll move people in batches, you know. So, like for example, the plane that will carry people carries about 360 people per flight. So, by the time you have done 10 flights back to back, you have done a good number.
Now you've done all the arrangements with the carriers. Who are these carriers that will be involved?
Two major airlines are flying us this year. Mm-hmm. One is Atlas Jet, and it's an airline based in Turkey, and the second is Air First, an airline based in Nigeria.
Okay.
And we're working together with them to ensure that things move very well.
All right, we'll return to you and check out other arrangements. But let's go on to Reverend Israel Akonji and find out what's the significance of Christians going to Israel on pilgrimage.
Well, going to Israel is very significant. It is fulfillment of biblical injunctions in various ways. Sometimes people ask the question, does the Bible really say we should go to Israel before God answers our prayers? Mm-hmm. You know, the Bible doesn't say it is only in Israel that prayers are answered. God answers prayers everywhere. But then there is a special encounter when one has the privilege to go to the Holy Land. Psalm 48 says that great is the Lord and greatly to be praised in the city of the Lord, in the mountain of his holiness. It says that beautiful for situation, the joy of all whole earth is Mount Zion and the sight of the Lord. So we are talking about a place where you have special encounters. You can pray everywhere, but I do really know that God expects us from time to time to take some retreat to quiet places to pray. And if we do so, even in our own country, going to the land of Israel offers us a greater opportunity, because a lot of what we read in scriptures, we come face to face with them, and we encounter great biblical symbols and great, you climb on the mountains that Jesus climbed, you pray on the mountain where Jesus prayed, you experience the encounters of the children of Israel as they came from Egypt and went to the land of Canaan. All wonderful promises, and as soon as you encounter those, your heart connects with the scriptures, and then you are able to pray and internalize and personalize some of these encounters in such ways that your life does not remain the same again. So it's an experience you cannot compare with worshiping or praying anywhere, because it is like the sublime. You are now in the land of the Bible, on the Sea of Galilee, where it really happened, with Jesus on the sea, with the storm that was tossing the sea and the boat, and the experience of calmness and everything on the same sea. It becomes so engaging for our hearts, and it easily helps us to mix up with faith, our faith with that encounter, and we never remain the same actually after we go.
Right, Reverend Sam Ogbodo, I'd like to expand on that, on the benefits that might accrue from this exercise.
Well, as a young child or young Christian reading through the Bible, in those days I assumed that hearing of Israel, Jerusalem, and they are all in heaven, only to grow up and discover they are on earth here with us. So as an adult Christian, having the privilege of going to Israel is experiencing the Bible, like our Father and the Lord said, having a first-hand experience of the Bible, that Jesus died and resurrected is not just a story, it's not a theory. You go to see the grave where Jesus was buried, from where he resurrected and ascended to heaven. He get to the Mount Olive where his feet was before he finally went to heaven. He's having a first-hand experience. So it's like hearing of a thing and now having a witness, experiencing it, you know, the thing. That's how Israel is. And Israel is a land of covenant with God. The first time I went to Israel, I truly saw that it's a land of promise, like God said. The development, the faith-building experience, you know that God is in that land, and what God said in the Bible is practical. So it's actually a wonderful place to go. And we encourage every Christian, you can't go to Israel and come back on pilgrimage. It's a spiritual exercise that changes life, that transforms your life. It brings you a revival. It increases your faith. It assures you that what you're reading in the Bible is real. The miracles of Jesus are real. The Sea of Galilee are real. Going there and coming back assures you that any prayer you pray to God, you're sure of having the answers. And I suddenly go and come back with testimonies.
Mm. All right. And, so let's go over to Mr. Sunday Ude, who's head mobilization of the Christian Pilgrims Commission now. Your title suggests that you'll have a lot to do with the pilgrims and mobilizing them. First, let's get this. This isn't limited to Israel. It's Rome and Greece. So what are the, you know, What's the arrangement like for Israel, Rome, and Greece?
Okay, thank you so much. Like the title suggests, mobilization. And in the course of doing that, people ask a whole lot of questions. For instance, somebody might ask you, is it only Israel? Are there no other sites? In the course of mobilizing people to go on pilgrimage, the first thing is to assure them that this is not just one of those trips, like you go on holiday. It's a journey of an encounter. We started with Israel. We also go to Rome, especially for faithfuls who value certain encounters in those areas. We go to Greece as well. And we're also moving on expanding to the seven churches in Asia, which is now in present day Turkey. And we're hopefully going to keep, you know, moving further and further and further. Am I also interested to know that Cote d'Ivoire, we also have some holy sites that appeal to some Christians. We've as well explored those areas, and we're just putting finishing touches to the program as it fits, you know, the segment of the Christian that it appeals to, and our people are very willing to go to those places. So in mobilizing people, it's important that the values of pilgrimage comes to life. You know, like the Reverend had said, first of all, Bible comes alive to you. You don't miss that. You know, you have read this story. We have been praying about these things. Like my ears will say that first we believed, even before going to see these places. So Bible comes alive to you. You just look at it, you see that these are not fiction. These are not just stories told by people, by random men and women. These are actual events. So when we mobilize people, we let them realize that this is the reason for this movement. These are the sites we go to. Like you said, we're going to do our flag off from Yola. First time ever doing that. And it's not just first time, but it's also giving a sense of belonging, because pilgrimage is about, you know, showing people that you care. When you come to the Holy Land, this is what happens. So these are the values we bring when we mobilize people to go on pilgrimage.
I need to add something right there. Mm-hmm. You know, Greece is not one of the places Jesus really went to. Mm. Nor Italy. Mm. Nor any of these other places. Mm. He walked strictly in Israel, according to the prophetic demand of God. However, Greece is the place where about 75% of Apostle Paul's ministry work took place. Mm-hmm. Most of the New Testament books are from Greece. Thessalonica, Galatians,
all of them.
Athens, all the places. So it's important for people to see this and to rekindle their faith. And when I went to Greece for the first time, to survey the land and see some of the places, I prayed for Nigeria, that let the church in Nigeria not come to this point ever. Mm. Because it's difficult to find a Christian in Greece. It's difficult to find anything alive. But this was the place that bubbled in the days of Paul. Like Italy is the place that bubbled in the days of Peter. And some of the other places, or like Ethiopia, bubbled in the days of the Ethiopian eunuch. Now, one of the things we are designed to do is that while we accept people going to these places, the bottom line of pilgrimage is Jesus Christ. Mm. So Israel has to be part of it. You know, wherever you begin, Israel is the bottom line.
Now, how is this package like? Since, you know, I have Israel, Rome, and Greece. How's the package like? Is it just one containing all of these? Or pilgrims have a chance to choose whether they want to go to Rome or to Greece, or how is this packaged?
Yes, you have a choice, but the choice is that Rome and Greece are a choice.
Okay.
So you either pick Rome or Greece in addition to
Israel. In addition to Israel. Israel is constant. So you either choose to go to Rome or you choose to go to Greece.
Yes.
All right. Okay, well, we'll be taking on so many of all those things now. And next we would find out, this is what has, at the start of it, I do know that quite a number of people were a little bit uncomfortable when they heard that there was going to be a lottery as to how to, and some people raised concerns that, hang on a moment, a lottery to decide to go on pilgrimage, how did that come about?
I think it was just a matter of nomenclature, a matter of inappropriate presentation. Actually, it's not exactly a lottery. It's a program of making the pilgrimage available even to those that have no money. So the program was conceived in a manner that tickets are produced and people buy tickets for 500 naira. And when the tickets are sizable enough, they decide the few people who will go on pilgrimage. I think at first the conception was that you will do a lottery.
Mm-hmm.
And we said, no. The Christian doctrine does not really create room for lotteries. So what we did is that people buy lotteries. For example, your church can buy the tickets. And when you sell the number required, you use your means in your church to select those who will go on the pilgrimage. It costs about 500,000 to send somebody on pilgrimage, though we are working towards reducing that cost in the future, but we'll talk about that another time. Mm. But when people buy the tickets, they will decide those who will go on the pilgrimage. It's not as if you are going to do a gamble kind of thing, no.
All right, so because a lot of people...
actually, it's a fallout of government decision to encourage people to go on pilgrimage on their own.
Yeah.
And, you know, with the economic situation and several other things, and even before the economic recession, we had been receiving warning that pilgrimage should be seen as a private thing that one wants to do, and one wants to get closer to God in encounter. It brings spiritual rebirth, it brings transformation to life and to the community and to our country in general. And so in ways of trying to find alternatives so that it wouldn't just be the rich people alone that can go, but other people that cannot afford it. What are some ways? I think that's what brought about okay, let's all drop in some money, and then at the end of the day, some people will be able to go. And even if one person goes, he has been sponsored by all the others to go.
So you do have mechanisms in place to ensure that those who actually benefit from this are those who you might term to be indigent, who ordinarily might not be able to afford about 500,000, like you said.
Yes, in a sense.
Somebody doesn't come to...
that's a clarification I want to bring
right.
Here.
Yes.
Sometime in 2013, we'll have a group of farmers in KB states. Over time, they began to contribute money on their own.
Mm-hmm.
The initial intention was that, okay, if we have enough this year, this person can go.
Mm-hmm.
We'll keep contributing. If we raise enough, we can sponsor the next person. They sponsored to a good extent.
Mm-hmm.
Incidentally, every of their contribution couldn't send one person.
Oh dear.
But I had a group number of them. And then a particular philanthropist heard about that and said, okay, I'll complete it for them. And then they began to ask questions. Then another time again, we had some people from Kano State. Three of them, actually, kept on, you know, saving, because we also have some other schemes, like saving schemes, you know. Kept on saving money. First year, couldn't go. Second year, they say, okay, well, we can return back to our farm. So at that time, it became obvious that are so many Nigerians, so many Christians, who intend to go on this pilgrimage. It could cost them less. If we say a ticket is, say, 500 naira or maybe 1,000 or 2,000 naira, as the case may be, they can pull together. One person wins. As I speak with you, we have a group of pastors, as I speak with you now, in Maraba area.
Mm-hmm.
They've started the same process. The idea is that they get to a point, we can begin to make appeal to many Nigerians and say, help them.
Mm-hmm.
Because we have so many Christians who are spiritually very rich, but materially they can't afford it. This could be an avenue through which we can give everybody equal opportunity.
Very important to add that the name we have given to that project is no longer Win a Ticket.
No.
All right.
Is Support a Pilgrim to Israel.
Yes.
Sapti.
Sapti.
Support a Pilgrim to Israel.
Pilgrim
to Israel.
Sapti.
To Israel.
Yes.
So Sapti. That is now Sapti.
Yes. All right. So even when you pay, you are not paying so that you must win.
Mm-hmm.
You are paying so that somebody else can win.
Yes.
Yeah.
And sometimes some people who have money, some can buy a ticket for 100,000 just to contribute and make sure somebody else goes.
Mm-hmm. All right. Mm-hmm. So that clears the air over.
the whole idea is that there are so many people who will not be able to afford it.
Yes.
And every means of assisting them to go is to be explored. We are really grateful because through the years we have always had one person who will want to support several people to go.
Yeah.
But the more people go and come back and tell the story of their experience, the more people want to go.
Mm-hmm.
And so we are not also closing the aspect of individuals sponsoring others. And I do really hope that those who have gone and have had wonderful experiences can take out of what God blesses them with to support another person to go. Because I remember the first time I went, all I was praying for is that, God, I want you to provide so that my wife can come. I wanted somebody else to come immediately. Mm-hmm. And, well, God has answered that. And I think I shouldn't stop in trying to help somebody to go. And those that are blessed, too, should help somebody to go.
Yeah.
It will be a great encounter that they will never forget. And when they go there, they will pray for you in thanking God. They cannot pay you back, but they will lift you up to God. And definitely, you will also be greatly blessed for sponsoring them.
I went to one state recently. And the governor sponsored some people to go to pilgrimage. That governor is a Muslim. And he sponsored some people who are going on pilgrimage with us now. And the governor told me that he has only two requests. That he wants the Christians who are going on pilgrimage to pray for his state and for him. And to pray for the president and the vice president, that these people mean well, and if God helps them, they will transform this nation.
Mm-hmm.
That's all the reason he's supposed to put to go.
Yeah.
I felt that was something that many people need to emulate.
Yeah.
He's not looking for money, he's not looking for anything.
Mm-hmm.
He's not looking for another appointment. He's looking for the future of his state and the future of this country. It's something that people need to look out for and to sponsor pilgrimage.
Right. Reverend Ogbodo, how have Christians keyed into the whole process of going on pilgrimage, experiencing the rebirth, which you've all talked about?
Yeah. Nigerian Christians, I think it's an exciting program. Like I said, it brings a lot of transformation. From my association, I've seen people who, in the land of Israel, come with particular requests of healing. So I'm a witness to a woman from Adamawa State in our group. She came there a diabetic, and she returned home healed. And people, hearing that testimony, are also willing to go to where she got her healing. Just like our father says, it's not as if God is not in Nigeria. God is everywhere. God is everywhere. But it's a promise. The Bible says, blessed is he that goeth for pilgrimage in Jerusalem. It's a prophetic declaration and is the desire of every Christian to go to that place where God had declared that men should come. And people who have gone came back with testimonies. People are willing to go, but like you've heard our brother say, that one problem, one challenge people are having is finances. People who can sponsor themselves are doing that. But those who cannot, through the churches and through women in Nigeria, are also willing to go and they're beginning the support. And we're trusting God that more people will be enlightened. At the time, I brought NCPC to the church to talk about pilgrimage. only to discover that not many Christians know that they can go on pilgrimage on their own.
Mm.
It was after the Enlightenment that families started paying. So they have a family, a man, he went with his wife and children. They said they thought it was restricted to government, for government to select those who will go at a particular time and at other time. I said, no, the people never knew they can on their own pay their way to Israel. And from that time, people have been buying from, going to the website of SCPs, downloading from field, and go to Jerusalem.
All right, the phone lines are open. We have our very first caller tonight, John, who's calling in from Cross River. Hello, John. Go ahead.
Hello, sir.
Yes. Yes, John. Hello. Go ahead.
Hello.
Hello. Go ahead.
Hello. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Okay. Thank you for the program. I'm calling from Cross River State. I'm Mr. John.
Right.
Yes, I've enjoyed all you said on the program. And I wish to ask, assuming somebody that wish to go on this pilgrimage that we are discussing about, and what are the necessary steps one could take in order to be a participant?
All right. Okay, that's the question. Yes, certainly. I guess we're straightforward. Wants to know the steps to take. Christian wants to go on pilgrimage. What's the first thing he should do? How does he go around doing that?
It's all right. The first thing is that pilgrimage is a journey of faith. If you want to go on pilgrimage, you go to our website. You can www.ncpc.gov.ng. You can get the form over there. Fill out the forms accordingly. You can as well go to the Christian Pilgrim Welfare Boards that are all over the states as well. You can obtain your form over there. We also have the Christian Pilgrim operators. You can as well, you know, go to them. But the first thing is that you must have a form, your form filled appropriately, submit them. You'll be called for a screening when we look at your documents, look at your, you know, to be sure you are fit to go. We look at the medical, you know, and we look at the security. We look at everything and then ensure that you are fit to go. Ensure, first of all, that you're a Christian who desires of an experience or an encounter in the Holy Land. The moment that is done and you're fit to go, then you can now go and pay the fee to embark on pilgrimage. That is the process. It's simple. Where it's made simplified. But I want to touch on something.
No, let me add something to that, because you just mentioned that after you fill the form, they will screen you and your medical condition will be ascertained. That is not to scare you away, because that is where you hear that there are arrangements for a huge number of medical personnel to go, because, yes, people may have medical issues. They just want to know what your medical issue is so that they can prepare to assist you and so that they can help you know some areas you cannot go because of your medical condition. But then medical condition does not mean you should run away. Well, since they will screen me, that means they will disqualify me. They don't screen for the purpose of disqualifying you. Mm-hmm. They will screen so that we will know your condition and know how to help you when you get there. I just want to add.
It's all right. The only people we don't allow at all is if you're pregnant. We don't allow you to embark on the journey because of the strenuous nature of the place. But we talked about transformation, you know, initially. It might interest you to know that we've moved ahead as well in the course of mobilizing people to go on pilgrimage to introduce a lot of other programs, other things, skill acquisition, leadership program. I remember when one of them came back with my secretary in the last program, he said, "Why wouldn't you go to classroom and teach?" Because he said, "I never had anybody talk to me like this." It's not just, you know, biblical principles are not just about, I don't know how people look at faith. It's also about what you can do. We teach people. we have, I give one example about a particular sister from Edo State that went before, started with, after visiting the site, started with a few beds, about 15 of them. As that when she came to do a presentation to us, she has over 5,000 beds. Just trying to apply what she was able to grasp within the time frame. So in terms of transformation, we're looking at the holistic approach to the Christian person, to the Christian mind, not just to pray, but also to learn, you know, wisdom and knowledge.
All right, we'll return to that because we're particularly interested in this skills acquisition program. But let's take our second call, this one coming from Rivers. Bethel, who's calling in from Rivers. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Please, let me first of all thank you all for presenting this wonderful presentation. My question is this. One of the presenters earlier said that the program is meant for those persons that is in spiritually inclined. So I want to ask, there is some person that went for privilege, they are not even a Christian. I know sometimes ago when I pray some forms, but my name was removed. Those persons that are not a Christian, the new Christian, they were opportune to go because of their personality they know in the board and all that. So we that have less privilege, they were unable to shortlist our name. So I just want to ask, what should be our hope if the next batch, what should be the hope of a common man if the next batch is about going when we apply? So that is the question I have.
All right. This, Bethel, this it's a very serious issue you raised here, and certainly the executive secretary will address this matter. You heard the man said at some point in time, people applied to go on pilgrimage, their names were substituted, those who were not even Christians, as he said, and he's wondering. So what are the arrangements in place to ensure that people do not lose out only on the basis of their being not privileged, as he said?
No, better. Thank you for what you have said. I may not know the entire circumstances surrounding the situation in which you couldn't travel. In some cases, I don't know if you paid or somebody paid, because sometimes somebody who pays gives the qualities of the people he wants to go. Maybe you didn't fit into it or something. But I can tell you something better. One of the goals we have set in NCPC is to make it possible for every Nigerian Christian to be able to go on pilgrimage at least once in his lifetime. So our goal is inclusive. It includes you. It includes everybody. We have no desire to look at anybody's face per se. It's for everybody who is desirous. We'll create a situation for it. In the coming year, we are taking steps to drastically reduce the cost of pilgrimage in order to enlarge the scope and enable more people to attend. So it is not out of who you know. You don't need to know anybody. We are biblically based and we are genuine in our arrangement. If anything happened to you, we apologize for it, but I don't think anybody would deliberately put you aside.
Yeah,
I want you to apply again.
Yeah.
Right.
There is something I want to say. Thank you, Bethel, for your question. And like the ES said, we may not know the total circumstances around the person. It may not be that you were excluded for just because you did not know people. There are times when during screening, we see people who probably appear to be people who may not want to return to Nigeria. if you look so young and ambitious and unmarried and you look unemployed. You're unemployed, you are just somebody sponsoring you, the fear of abscondment comes to the pilgrims group interviewing you, and that may be the reason. And if you try again and try again, the door may open. So there are usually several factors.
Now, in furtherance to this, is there a way for people who, well, have suffered this same fate of Beth? Is there a place where they can appeal to if you appear before screen and you turn down? Do you have any recourse to appeal to anybody?
There's an appeal.
Okay.
And anybody can appeal. For example, just 2 weeks ago, we did screening in some 3 states. And the leaders of the pilgrim welfare in those states appealed to me, to my office, that they felt too many of the people were stopped from traveling. And I sent the second team to go and rescreen. And they came back, the results were almost the same. Okay. Like Bishop Israel Konji said, many of the people who are denied is for now. Because some are very young.
Well, you're not convinced that they're going there for spiritual purposes, right?
We are not convinced that if they go back, they will follow us back.
Right. Okay. You know. All right, we'll still return to that. But do we have another caller from Oyo? Hello? Zacchaeus from Oyo, I believe. Yes, go ahead.
Hello, good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Zacchaeus Olalua, calling from Oyo State.
Yes.
I am very happy to come across this program this evening. The question I just want to ask is that what are the measures put in place to choose or to select the people that want to go to this pilgrimage, especially those that are less privileged? So my question is very similar to what the other person asked. Now, and one of the speakers now just said that due to the fear of people absconding, so you may just decide not to pick some people. So what are the measures put in place to know or to detect that these people might actually abscond?
All right, Zacchaeus. Yes.
Okay. Something I would say with regards to, I don't know what he means by less privileged here. I don't know whether it's in terms of resources or a physical challenge. If it's a physical challenge, we'll have a program for people like that when they go on pilgrimage. In fact, we'll have a specific ground handler. This is just their job. They handle physically challenged people. They handle older people, the elderly people. We have that in place. Now, when it comes to the other aspect, if you say less privileged, maybe in terms of resources, something is very obvious. The amount you paid for going on pilgrimage is not something you just pick by the wayside. It's something you work overtime to be able to say, I want to go. You make up your mind you want to go. Some people, like my reverend has said, they'll just come. Even to fill the form, they can't fill the form. Their form, they can't fill the form. We start by posing a lot of challenges on our own. I'll give you one instance. I went for an America visa interview some time ago. A particular woman and a son came. Even before they asked the first question, the woman fell on the floor and started crying. If you refuse me, I will not leave here today. So incidentally, you sound so desperate. Desperation makes people lose focus. There's something passionate I've seen in my ears. Simple. The greatness of Nigeria and the Nigerians. If somebody wants to go on pilgrimage, first of all, you don't even value your country. You don't even care. It means you are not going for the same exercise for which we have set this program. There's a reason for pilgrimage. The moment your intention begins to deviate from that purpose for which pilgrimage was put in place, you lose it. If you look through the Bible, the Ethiopian eunuch, Bible said, has been going. But he was studying the Bible, but was not even understanding, but had a yearning that that I want to learn. So when Philip encountered him, it was easy. The chemistry just worked because an expectant soul, you know, somebody who's looking up to something. If you're not expecting nothing, just that people are going. My other brother, you can imagine, somebody I encountered is actually from my place. Okay? His other brother called me to say, you can't stop him. I said, my dear brother, I wanted to explain something to you. He can go on you. He said, no, there's nothing else I want. I have sold my property in a particular state to raise money for him. You can immediately say, hey, this one is not for the same purpose for which we are doing this. Mm. So there are certain level of desperation you see in young people. You definitely know, I'm not going for your own program.
I need to add a word
for my own program.
That Zacchaeus and any other Nigerian who may be having this challenge, you will find that in all honesty, somebody may pay for you, which qualifies you to go. But that is not enough. Sometimes, even at the airport, we stop people from going. Sure. Because through the machines, you see they are carrying palm oil. They are carrying Maggi. Now, you know, on pilgrimage, you don't cook. We make arrangements with all the places where they are going to feed us 3 meals a day. So when you see people with those kind of artifacts, you know that their plan is to go and be a cook somewhere. They plan to go and stay away. So we stop them from going. And some others, for different reasons. So we analyze that if somebody even paid for you, but you don't have a fixed address, we can't trace you. You know, this last pilgrimage we went in July, August, on the eve of the interview, one man came and paid 500,000 naira into the accounts of 16 young men who were coming for interview the same day. So we said, do you have means? We said, oh, we're rich. Now we got their statements, all of them, the 500,000 was paid by the same person the same day in 16 accounts. So it became clear that this man is trying to send people who will go and abscond and be in Israel. Mm. So it may not be obvious to everybody else, but we do a lot of scrutiny because we want Nigerians to go and come back. One of the greatest things you have to do as a Christian is go and find Christ and come back and build this nation, because this is a great nation that is looking for leadership, spiritual leadership especially. And we want our young men to go to Israel and come back and make a living contribution. I go to Israel, I find young people who are fighting for their nation. All the soldiers in Israel, they are in their 20s. Nobody's in their 30s. And they put up their lives for their nation. All the people on the farms, they are young people. And they are laboring for their country. Why does a Nigerian want to abscond into Israel or into America or into any country? Because you think they are living better? This country is better than any country I know in the world. Mm. I want Nigerians to stay here, especially if you're a Christian, you have a labor to do. I tell you something, Siri, in a few years to come, the world is going to be fighting over itself to come to Nigeria. Amen. Because we are making Nigeria a pilgrim's destination. Amen. That will take place.
Now, Siri, okay. One other thing is that, you see, it is better we stop you from going than allow you take your flight, land in Israel at Ben Gurion Airport. As you get to the passport officer, he sends
Israeli
you back.
Israeli authority will turn you back.
You know, because they have their own way of detecting even people who are able to escape from us. Mm. Sometimes we are shocked to know that this person that we think has no problem has been to Israel before. They have his records and everything, the same name and everything. When it comes up in their computer, they will just tell you, sorry, this one cannot go with you. And it is more embarrassing at that time. So it's always better to weed off people we have suspicion for. But then, if they really have passion for it, they will come up another year and come up, and it will soon be their turn.
Okay, let's go to Port Harcourt. We have Lazarus from Port Harcourt calling in. Hello, Lazarus.
Hello, good evening, sir.
Yes, good evening.
Yeah, I'm so glad for the program, and my contribution is, whether is there any means that both the camp president, both the pastors that are there with you, where people can have something like universities for young Christians that are poor to go to universities or to have an educational background. So whether is there anything people can do there, unlike what the topic says, that's just my own contribution, because there are a lot of people there that are eager to go to school, but the finances and their background is very low. So whether people can do anything there, maybe by having any schools or building a particular school for those people. Thank you.
Okay.
I think
it's for can say whether they can build a university.
Yeah.
Right. Where they can have.
I think maybe Lazarus is his name.
Yes.
I think Lazarus is kind of looking at the skill acquisition that we are talking about.
All right.
As if we are sending people to school there, and there may be those who may not be able to afford it.
Maybe we should talk in more detail about this skills acquisition.
Yeah. Right. Well, let me just say that skill acquisition is actually a short time but intensive training to help a person be able to develop skill in certain areas. There is so much that we can do in Nigeria, but we may not be aware. When you get to the land of Israel, you cannot but be fascinated by a country where their rainfall is almost zero, and yet their vegetation covers the whole ground, and they export to all parts of the world. You will now be asking, if this land is this dry, why will our own land in Nigeria, where we have good rainfall, not be able to produce better things? And you just discover that you need some training. That's the kind of training we are talking about. People have done training in farming of some kind of vegetation, and then of rearing birds and taking care of other livestock and things like that. That's the training we are talking about, Lazarus. But you seem to be saying that probably Christian Association of Nigeria should establish a school where people who are less privileged can go and make it cheap enough.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you, Lazarus, I'm with you on this, and I pray that the church in Nigeria will be able to have such a university where those who do not have enough funds will be able to be assisted, and that God will give us people who will so generously contribute to such an institution. There are rich people in Nigeria. Let them contribute so that people like Lazarus talking can have such opportunity. I wish that it will happen, and I will surely tell them at our meeting in Cannes that there is a dimension of thought of how to help people who are not able to pay school fees to gain access to education.
But can I add that there are public schools that government is subventing that are reasonably cheap? All my children, I have five daughters. All of them have gone through public schools. None has gone to a private university. None. And I don't think they are disadvantaged. I never went to any private school in my life. I'm not disadvantaged. So I don't think you need to necessarily go to a high-brow private school to have good education. The public schools are still very good.
Okay. It's to Kaduna now we go. We have another caller, Oku from Kaduna. Hello. Oh, dear.
But may I also add quickly?
Seems that call is not...
A lot of churches also have programs like that. It's not just enough to say less privilege. Mm. You know, some of us, if we tell our stories here, we might not leave, but we're here. Churches have such programs, but they set criteria for you to be able to come in.
It's
not just available for everybody.
Well, I guess what the caller was referring to was the issue of certain congregations, churches, putting up institutions where the congregation contributes to, and at the end of the day, most of the children of those who put up the money can't even afford to go to that. But that's another question altogether. Which
for another day.
For another day. Which we'll look at.
But I think it's important to still mention that those who come on pilgrimage and have access to skill acquisition, they always come back with something.
Now, and that's where what I want to stay a little bit on. And how do you determine who is a beneficiary of the skills acquisition pilgrimage?
No, the skills acquisition program is particularly targeted
to the youth
and the young people.
Okay, and is there a separate arrangement for those who benefit from this?
The answer is yes. When we take the youth pilgrimage, the young people on pilgrimage, it is only them, because we are both taking them to pilgrimage sites for prayer and other things, but also taking them to training locations for particular trainings, both in agriculture and some other technical areas like ICT and infrastructural development and other technical areas. You know, so everybody among the youth who go participate. Now, one of the experiences I had is that I had to combine the youth and the family pilgrimage because of the time management that we had to handle. So when we got there, the parents who went with their children didn't take them for youth pilgrimage. They went as family pilgrimage. But they released their children to follow the other youth. So when the children came back and started sharing the things, the parents now say, no, we want to be part of what the youth are doing.
Yeah.
So we collapsed into all the skill acquisition, and it was excellent. It was both leadership training, agriculture, and infrastructural development programs.
Okay.
They were excellent, and everybody benefited. I learned a lot from it, too.
Mm. All right. Lagos is where we go. We have Izu calling in from Lagos. Hello.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Good evening. I just want to contribute to your program.
Mm-hmm.
I just listened to what that pastor said, the one on white, about the Israelite, that people should stop going to abroad, that in the next 2 years, Nigeria is going to be a better place. But I'm like disagreeing with what he said, because what is clear, the problem we have here in Nigeria is that we don't love each other. People are graduating from university every year, and there is no work. There is no work. So how are we going to cope? No life. Our government, this present government, what has it put in place? So this is what you are going to consider. Let me tell you, if I have the opportunity, I will leave this country.
All right.
We are praying that God will help us.
Okay. Thank you, Izu. Right. The topic tonight is the Christian pilgrimage, and the aspect about coming back here was only brought in to underline the fact that the commission would screen pilgrims and perhaps those whose intentions are not purely religious to go to Israel and pilgrimage and come back would be screened out, because the commission would not allow people to abscond and stay away. That was what brought that discussion. So it's got nothing to do with those who are graduating, have no jobs, who want to leave the country and go somewhere else.
But he has brought in something.
We'll save that, discussion for some day.
You see, I have always thought that Nigerian youth are ingenious, they are courageous, and they are inventive. I think this is a sad tale for a Nigerian youth and a Nigerian graduate to say, if I have a chance to run away from this country, that is cowardice. I want to tell you that the mantle of building this nation is on our shoulders. When we went on one of the pilgrimages and we had an instruction on leadership, and we brought an Israeli to teach on leadership with the experience of David Ben-Gurion, I'm telling you, the pictures we saw when Israel was formed in 1938, that place was just stones and rocks and villages. There was nothing. But today, Israel is one of the most developed nations in the world. The Israeli army is known to be the most motivated in the world. The Israeli economy is one of the most developed, because they put their minds to battle the desert, to battle the stones, to battle the lack of water, and to turn their land into what God promised to be. God has made a promise to Nigeria. I believe that promise. I believe that Nigeria, in a short while, will be turned into one of the greatest nations on earth. And I want men of courage, young and old, to give the attention to that is one of the reasons for pilgrimage. That if you see what is there, you should come and replicate it in your nation, because Nigeria can be greater.
Mm-hmm. All right. And that's at this point, we'll take a short break. Stay with us on NTA Tuesday Night. We'll be back after these messages.
Nigerians, our fearless officers and men of the Nigerian military are winning the war against Boko Haram. Today, all occupied territories have been recovered and Boko Haram has been degraded. Our affected brothers and sisters are getting their lives back. However, they are now after you and me. In our mosques, churches, schools, motor parks, markets, entertainment centers, and public gatherings. Be vigilant. Be security conscious. Report suspicious persons, objects, and movements to the police and other security agencies. The security of our nation is a duty for you and me. Nigeria, unite against terrorism.
This message is brought to you by the Federal Ministry of Information and Culture.
The struggle for independence had been a long and tough one. Our founding fathers and compatriots sacrificed their comfort and even shed their blood. We cannot at this point in history afford to spirit away their sacrifices for immediate but temporary gains of today. Let us emphasize what unites and not what divides us. Working for the unity of purpose, with a stronger vision for a better tomorrow. NTA, growing with the nation.
Nigeria, the only country we can train with remarkable potentials to excel. Let us believe in ourselves and change our attitude for the sake of our country and generations unborn. Let us revive our cultural values, which are our essence as a nation. Let us renew the spirit of patriotism and hope in our dear country. Do not take or give bribe. Be punctual always. No more African time. We can't expect to be global citizens and operate on African time. Join the queue. Insist that people are attended to on a first-come basis, no matter who they are or where they come from.
Nigeria, good people, great nation.
Make you report any crooked person, object or wakajube movement to police and security agent demo.
The security of our nation now work for all of us, plus including me and you.
Nigeria, make we unite against terrorism. Now, Federal Minister of Information and Culture, bring on this message.
Tuesday Live, a network issue-oriented innovation talk show.
Thanks for staying with us. Tonight we've been discussing the 2016 Christian pilgrimage. And at this point, let's look at the plans the commission is believed to have to create six more pilgrimage zones. And this is part of what it says are measures to ensure cost-effectiveness.
No, we want to take pilgrimage to the people, closer to the churches and closer to the communities. Already right now, as NCPC, we have six operational zonal centers, which are in Lagos, in the southwest, and the geopolitical center, as you know them. We decided to double them and to create special centers. We made Lagos a special center. We made Port Harcourt a special center. We made Onitsha a special center. We made Kano a special center. We made Gombe a special center. And we also made Abuja a special center. But in addition to that, we intend to create heritage centers. And by that I mean we're building an infrastructure that will house a conference center as well as a farm center and some educational training facility. One of the goals is that all those who are going on pilgrimage from next year must come and spend at least 3 days in that center for orientation, for re-education, and to even make Pattern you see the beauty and the glory of Nigeria that many people have not seen, because many people don't know it. So right over the years, we do a 30-minute to 1 hour orientation at the airport and we join the plane. It's not enough. We want people to spend 3 days with us for prayers, for some education, for Bible studies, and very importantly, for a nationalistic program development. So that we are going out as proud Nigerians. We are going out as people of honor. We are going out representing a nation. We are not just going out as idle people going to admire us, jump into another man's land. We are going with our pride intact. And in fact, one of the things we did is that over the years, when we go on pilgrimage, I'm sure many of you who have been there have come back with bags by the different ground handlers with their names and companies on it, with the T-shirts, with the caps, which you wear around. What you don't know is that you are advertising their company at no pay. And in any case, all those things they are producing, we paid them for it. So I told them, no, you cannot produce things in your name and give us. You must produce them in the name of Nigeria. If you are producing your name, you will pay us for it. Otherwise, we don't use it. But we have changed it. Actually, the airplane that is going to carry us, they sent me the brand photograph this evening. They have put the Nigerian colors on it, and they have labeled it with big, bold labels of Nigeria. Yeah. You know, Christ Pilgrims, Nigeria. Nigeria is boldly written on it. On our shirts and on our bags, Nigeria is boldly on it because we are proud of Nigeria. The last pilgrimage we went, I made uniforms for every pilgrim, green, white, green. So when we appeared in Israel in our hundreds, people were coming to interview us to ask us, what is the meaning of this? I say, a great nation has come into your land, Nigeria. You know, we want to do that training. So we're going to set up those centers in different parts of this country because we won't bring everybody to Abuja. We'll have one in Lagos, one in Port Harcourt, one in Gombe, and I think one in maybe Kano and Abuja, just about four or five for now. So in the zones, we'll be training everybody going on pilgrimage. You either come to that center for those 3 days or you won't fly, because we want to have a pattern and to succeed in that pattern.
All right. Let me come
besides,
to...
Besides, can I just add up something? The whole idea also is that instead of having someone who lives in Ilorin, Kwara State or something, finding all way through that to come to Abuja or to Lagos, you could find somewhere closer to you. At least the cost of all those travels, the dangers and that, things like that. It's just like bringing it closer to the people. That's just what we're trying to do.
Okay. All right. We have a call coming through from Calabar, I believe. Samuel from Calabar, go ahead. Do we still have Samuel?
Yeah, good evening, sir.
Yes, good evening. Go ahead.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Samuel.
Hello, sir. Good evening, sir.
Yes, good evening, Samuel. Go ahead. All right. I think we've lost that. There's something I want Reverend Samuel Godo to comment about, and this has been going on back and forth in different forums on this program, and it has to do with people going on pilgrimage, absconding, not coming back. And a while ago we had one caller say that if he had the chance he would leave this country. And you walk among the flock, you have your minister to people, and we've talked about the benefits, the spiritual benefits of going on pilgrimage. Now, I want you to address this fact that drives people to think that they would use this to leave their country and abscond and stay away, and what that does to this country, to the whole concept of a pilgrimage, and the spiritual rebirth that we talk about.
Yeah. the issue is that
If any man had the plan of absconding through pilgrimage, it shows in the first place that person is not a Christian. And the pilgrimage we are talking about is meant for Christians. We're going for an encounter. We're going to meet with God. Now, if the man has absconded, where is he going to? And what is his vision? What is he pursuing? Today is painful that we have many Nigerians. A few days ago, a Nigerian was hanged in Singapore for carrying drugs.
Sure.
These young men who are absconding, what are they doing? Are they going to get a better employment where they are going to or what? But the problem is because men have no vision. And the Bible says that where there's no vision, the people perish. Like we discussed, whatever a man can achieve outside Nigeria, he can achieve double of it. Because Nigeria is full of hope. You have many things you can do in Nigeria. You can do your business. As a person, I have never traveled and desired to stay more than 10 days outside Nigeria. Because all the freedoms you have, what are you looking for in Nigeria? Mm-hmm. Nigeria is the entire universe in miniature. Mm-hmm. Anything you're looking for, it's anywhere here. In the world, is here in Nigeria.
Good weather.
Good weather. Think about it. Good food.
Can say that again.
But the problem is because many young people don't know. False hope has been created in them. That if you go for a greener pasture somewhere, unfortunately for them, what they meet there are not really greener pastures, but dry pastures. But the shame of coming back is what is driving them. A lot of people in Nigeria, the other day, the essay to the president on diaspora said, we have over 118 Nigerians convicted for drugs. They are in prison. Nigerian young men are languishing in prisons. I hear people are running. Where are they running to? And it's a wrong route for you.
And many are also dying, trying to cross through the Atlantic. And so many are dying every day. The details has not even been told, but we know that many are dying. So any young person who wants to just go out of Nigeria because you think that it is by going out that things will be better, you may be making a lot of mistakes. You can look inwards and pray to God, and God will lead you. There are a lot of things you can do here. Many Nigerians are doing menial jobs over there. I don't know why there are even better jobs than that here, which some of them will say they cannot do. And many have prospered, not by their degrees. They've gone to the university. They've read one thing. They came out of university. They couldn't get to do that thing. They started doing another thing, and they have prospered in another field from what they studied. That means there are possibilities, and with God, all things are possible. Brother, God is here. He will help you in Nigeria.
All right. We have Stephen calling in from Ibadan. Hello, Stephen. Do we still have Stephen on the line? Hello?
Yeah, I'm doing that. Hello?
Yes, go ahead.
Hello?
Hello, Stephen, go right ahead.
Hello? Hello, Mr. Stephen from Ibadan. Hello?
Go on.
Hello, Mr. Stephen from Ibadan. Okay.
Well, here are you, Stephen.
What is the benefit of Nigerian Christians going for pilgrimage? Is it because the Muslims normally go to Hajj as per the... is it a kind of national cake? Or is it a kind of quota for Christians to enjoy what the Muslims are enjoying? But because most of the times, I don't know the reason what is attached to Christianity in going to pilgrimage. Sometimes they say in Rome, sometimes in Greece, sometimes say Jerusalem. Exactly, where are we supposed to be going? And what is the benefit? Is it financial benefit or spiritual benefit? That's my question.
All right, straightforward question. Why do we go on pilgrimage? Is it just because Muslims go on pilgrimage? Is there any spiritual benefit? You know, Reverend Akoji, I see you've opened the Holy Book.
Yeah, thank you very much for that question. You have started answering it yourself. Is it for spiritual benefit? Yes. Is it for material benefit? Yes. Because we have just spoken about skill acquisition and how it can make your life better. But here the word of God in the book of Micah, it says in chapter 4, it says, in the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as chief among the mountains. It will be raised above the hills, and peoples will stream to it. Many nations will come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways so that we may walk in his paths. The law will go out from Zion and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. The Bible expressly shows us that people can go to Jerusalem for spiritual benefits, for the benefit of prayer. And our brother Sonny was saying, he was speaking about the Ethiopian eunuch who had just gone to Jerusalem and was on his way back, and he had that spiritual encounter with Philip the evangelist, that going to Jerusalem has not just begun. In fact, you mentioned that, is it because Muslims go that Christians go? Let me tell you that historically, and this is accurate, even the Christians were going on pilgrimage before Muslims, historically. Because it was the Christians that even started. In the Bible, when Jesus was born, the Bible tells us that every year his parents will go to Jerusalem, to the temple in Jerusalem. It was a kind of pilgrimage. And when you read in the Bible that Jesus entered the temple and he was driving people who were selling and changing monies in the temple, these were pilgrims that were coming from other places, and they were using the temple to exchange money. And then Jesus sent them out and said, it was like a bureau de change, and Jesus sent them out and said, this is a house of prayer. It was people coming from various countries. So pilgrimage has always been a part of the Christian faith. And if you read Psalm 122, it says, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. And it talks about going to Jerusalem and praying. Therefore, it is for spiritual benefits. And I have gone to Israel, and I had issues that I presented to God in prayer. I tell you the truth, the Lord answered me. And part of the testimony of my being here today comes from even that experience of my going to Israel. So if God gives you the opportunity, you can go. If you cannot go, keep praying. But don't be angry with those who are going. And don't discourage those who want to go.
All right. Let's go to Lagos now. We have Alexander calling in from Lagos. Hello.
Yes.
Alexander on the line from Lagos.
Hello. Yeah, good evening, sir. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, we can hear you.
Yeah, I'm enjoying this your program.
Thank you.
But I want to quickly say something here. The second to the last speaker, Pastor, what he spoke about, the country Nigeria, we are all struggling, but the government is not encouraging the youth. I tell you, I have a critical issue right now caused by the government. I worked for the government since April this year. All my entire life savings. I borrowed money, left, right, front, center. I did the job, and I completed it. See, now I've not been paid. My three children are out of school, set two terms running now. Nobody to run to. I have written to the Public Complaint Commission. I have written to the Minister of Works because it's a road work. I have not been paid. I am indebted. Do you understand? Now, if I have the opportunity to leave this country, you think I want to come back here? Seriously, I tell you this. About a month ago, my wife attempted suicide because of people that I am owing. This is a country we call Nigeria. We have a religious body. The man, I wrote it later, and I submitted at...
Hello? Hello? Well, Alexander, looks like the line has gone dead, but all I'll say on this program is that there are many avenues for you, Alexander, to seek redress. And tonight again, let me restate that this program is about the 2016 pilgrimage. And Alexander, you do have issues with the government to do with the work that you've not been, the work you did that has not been paid for. There are so many avenues for you to seek redress.
You know, Cyril, right. I would still say that, you know, the Bible says that you cannot judge a man unless you hear him. We have just heard one side of the story, and we don't know. I sympathize with you, Alexander, but we have heard only one side of your story, because I know that in contract works, you do according to schedule, and you have certificates that are redeemed before work progresses. So, you know, anybody who has capacity to borrow has an enlargement. But I want to say here that there is a mentality that is wrong in this country, which the church must labor to disabuse. I am against anybody, and I'm serious, I pray against anybody who participates in the American lottery to go and be sweeping streets in America. You know, when I was doing the training for the medical personnel that we were taking to Israel, I told them a story of how some years ago, some two medical doctors absconded in Israel from Nigeria. Two medical doctors. And I said, this is crazy. In Nigeria, if you say you are a doctor, even if you have no job, everybody respects you.
Sure.
Now, these people stayed there for 2 years plus. They didn't get a job. They thought they would be employed in Israeli hospitals and they would earn plenty of dollars or shekel. Nobody employed them. Because the fact that you are even black, people around the world don't want to believe your credential. They didn't get a job. After 2.5 years, they went to one bush where Nigerian fellow abscondees were staying. And they were treating the fellow abscondees in their hut where they were staying. And I said, what kind of, I disrespect you if you are a qualified man and your mind is so weak. Because here in Nigeria, it is difficult for a doctor to be roaming the streets for long. You know, but that's what those two young men did. So I want to tell you that no matter the difficulties we have in this country, we are one of the countries with the biggest opportunities. I call Nigeria the land of opportunity and the land of privilege. All it demands from us is responsibility.
Right.
You know, I want every Nigerian to know that the destiny of greatness is in Nigeria. And God has blessed Nigeria for a purpose. If you like, run away. But those who stay will give a testimony of the great things God has done. I'm not speaking because of the economy. I'm not speaking for anybody. I'm speaking because of the covenant of God that we have in this nation. And it's a great covenant. I want us to be speaking the good things this country has done for us. Alexander, I'm sure Nigeria trained you. Nigeria made you a graduate. Nigeria gave you your education, your understanding, your experience, your networks. Nigeria gave you that contract. And Nigeria will pay that contract one day. You know, I've seen where contracts are owed for years, but they're paid.
Cyril, what we're just trying to establish is this pilgrimage is not leaving Nigeria forever. Pilgrimage is leaving Nigeria, going for an encounter, and returning. You know, that is what we call pilgrimage. Once you go and don't come back, it's no longer pilgrimage. Okay. It is another thing else. And we are talking about pilgrimage.
Right. We have a Godwin on the line. Godwin is calling from, hello? Taraba State. Godwin from Taraba. Go ahead.
Taraba. Taraba.
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Sir, I just want to say something in respect to the challenges. Yeah. The challenges I want to talk about here is the issue of what the pastor is just saying concerning the zoning training. I don't know where our normal state pilgrimage has been kept now. Because now, we are now making the challenges to be more harder for some of our parents to be there in, actually, somebody in Taraba to go to Gombe for 3 days training. Most likely, I don't know how and what were the things that you people have seen that you have created all things like this. Although I am happy with your advices on how you are encouraging the youth
to know the importance of their houses and how to stay in their houses and tap from the resources we have, especially in Nigeria. So I'm very happy, and I still wish that we should please try and organize pastors or our state prisoners delegates, that they will have this kind of a seminar to encourage us in our state so that we love our country the more. And somebody was talking, especially the person that is now presently, the first person by the right, left-hand side, was saying that you must be sure that you are, that you are born again before you make a move of going to Jerusalem, of which some of our journey to Jerusalem is a privilege. So I wish that you should really explain it very well, because some people in the altar, they come across and they get their salvation there. So I'm happy. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Godwin.
Well, we are here to assist everybody who wants to go on pilgrimage. The major concern is that if you are going on pilgrimage, like Reverend Akonji said,
so that you will come back,
you are a big asset. And we are willing to help you. We don't need to give preconditions. You know, on that pilgrimage, like he said, you can find Christ. We have set some definite goals that those who go on pilgrimage should find the Lord. It shouldn't just be an adventure or a journey or just a leisure trip, but a pilgrimage where you are looking for and you're going to find the Lord. And then secondly, not to get lost in what you see in Israel, but to know that you represent a great nation, and even if your nation does not have all the things you see in Israel or any other place, you are in a position under Christ to do those things in your country. I believe that very well. And thirdly, we want to see every Christian who goes on pilgrimage to see himself as a leader. God is raising you in leadership. And these are key component things we desire that you will get your exposure to pilgrimage. I thank you for that. In the new year, by the grace of God, we're going to hold this conference you are talking about, especially locally, conference of those who have been on pilgrimage, where men like this will share experience and teach from the Bible and give us what we're expected to do on return from pilgrimage. But I want you to trust God that what he has promised is available for us in this country, and Nigeria is going to lead the world.
All right, let's come to this other aspect that the pilgrims have left this country, and one of the things I'd like to know about is the welfare package. Earlier on, when we were talking, you did say some people were screened out because you found them carrying palm oil and possibly crayfish and stuff like that.
Yes, yes, so really.
What's in place in terms of welfare, talking about feeding and accommodation during the pilgrimage? Mm. So people will need to start hiding cups of gari or...
Is it those who hide... those who hide gari and crayfish and all those things are those who are planning to abscond.
Right.
Who want to use it, and maybe somebody contacted them and they are taking those things for him.
Who paid for them?
You know, otherwise, normally, we have been to Israel, we have met the ground handlers, we have supervised all the hotels, we have visited all the necessary places, because what you pay includes your transport, mm-hmm. both your flight, your local transport in Israel to all the sites, your accommodation in decent, beautiful hotels, your food 3 times a day, buffet, and sometimes more. And then everything you need is already provided for, all the materials you need to carry. And then the federal government has been generous enough to make the same provision for us as they made for Muslims, that they gave us money at the exchange rate of 197 naira to the dollar. That's many months back. We already bought that money and it's in our bank. So everybody going, you have a chance of buying a reasonable BTA. It's not much, 750 for everybody going to Jerusalem, but that is enough for you to do whatever you need to do, because we are not expecting you to go and buy Israel and bring it here. We expect you to come back with a better mentality, a better spirit, a healthy life
that will make you build a glorious nation in Christ and make an impact. So it is not what we buy in Israel that is the issue. Really, we discourage so much buying. We discourage people trying to gather things and bring here. We want you to come back with a life, with a mentality. So whatever a person is going to need is already arranged and paid for from what you are paid, what you paid.
All right. Okay, let's go over to Port Harcourt. We have Ubinna calling in from Port Harcourt. Ubinna, hello.
Hello, good evening.
Yes.
Thank you. Please, I have a little contribution to make about this program.
All right.
If my contribution is this. It is not bad for someone to go for a pilgrimage, but I believe it is more important for people to sponsor themselves by going to this pilgrimage than everyone else is capable of going for this pilgrimage. And second thing is this. In this country, Nigeria, we have Christian association of the country, and then our Christian brothers and sisters are dying every day in the hands of the Muslim brothers. And what are they doing about it? It is not confusing. Every day you hear that somebody is prison in Abuja is being slaughtered and nothing is done. And we're going for pilgrimage. Even the country where we're going to be pilgrimage, they're not doing anything about it. And we are people keep on dying and people are going for pilgrimage. Somebody said there that that the plane is being painted with green and white gold. What happens to our own plane here? We are using our resources to sponsor them to both countries. So why not use our own plane here, use our own resources, do things here? If they cannot, if they don't encourage what we have here, then they we're not doing anything. So I'm believing if you want to travel abroad, this is our economy, we are passing under two recessions. So why do we still carry our phone to another man's country to develop them? So please, I'm appealing to this country, Nigeria. Let us do the right thing at the right time. We are suffering. People are dying on daily basis. So many people have died, I know, in Port Harcourt out of hunger, and people are going for pilgrimage. So if we are to go for pilgrimage, let us also pray for this country, Nigeria, and still sit back at home and try to correct things in this country.
All right. Yes. Obinna.
That's precisely one of the reasons why we go for pilgrimage. We have the opportunity to separate ourselves from our daily routines in order to focus on God in prayer. And I tell you the truth that when people go on pilgrimage, one of the things that we usually remind ourselves of is that we are going on this pilgrimage to pray for our own country. Mm. I want you to know that a lot of prayers have been poured up to heaven concerning Nigeria. Things probably will have been worse than this, but we are grateful to God and that all who go will always pray. So the fact that we have problems does not mean we shouldn't go and seek opportunities for prayer and greater encounter. In fact, that itself will be part of what will bring the healing to our land, which we are asking God to do.
All right. And I must add that Nigeria's present condition is a very temporary condition. It will pass away. And the first place of dealing with that matter is in the spiritual realm, in prayer, in not only studying the Word of God, but obedience to the Word of God. One of the things we have in this country is that we have been so religious that we have not been godly. You know, we do everything, but we're not holy. We don't believe in righteousness. We need to believe in it. And so once we are beginning to establish ourselves on spiritual values, we are going to have a turnaround that will endure. This recession, for me, is an opportunity for Nigeria to be rebuilt on values, on spiritual values, on biblical values, on lasting values. Because if you don't adjust yourself, even if God brings us billions or trillions of dollars today, they may still disappear.
We will lavish it.
So we need to settle, because God is going to visit us again. But we need to put together both the spiritual and physical infrastructure that will enable us harvest what God is bringing to us. We're growing again as a nation. We're going to bounce back better. But let us bounce back when we have put our infrastructure together.
All right. We're still in Port Harcourt because we have another caller from there, Josephine this time. Hello, Josephine.
Hello.
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 Hello, your name is on screen. That means your call is through. Go ahead. Hello, hello, Josephine. We're waiting. All right. We'll just have to move on. Josephine is shy of the phone or the microphone there. So, right. Now, we've talked about the feeding and the accommodation. Now, one thing that has interested me since we started talking, you did talk about committees, those groups you've trained. You talked about medical. But again, you mentioned security. Now, what is this security group and what does it entail?
I will not say much because security issues are generally...
so that we get an idea. Security in terms of what?
But two things.
Right.
We want our people, first of all, to be safe because the Middle East is a volatile area.
Okay.
And I'm sure you know that right now we have discontinue for the moment. This is to the Sinai,
right?
Because of security challenges.
Okay.
As our security personnel give us information, we relocate, we rearrange our schedule, because we want every Nigerian who goes on pilgrimage to be safe and to come back well. So we don't want to expose any Nigerian to danger, and we want people who will give us information and the proper setup that will enable us to concentrate on the spiritual program we're out to do. You know, like during the pilgrimage, we have set aside 2.5 days that we're going to spend on Mount Zion, which you read about.
Mm-hmm.
And those 2 days will be for study, for prayer, and for spiritual focusing only. And we want to do it in an environment, in a setting where we are safe.
Okay.
And our people are supposed to provide those kind of structures that will enable us to be comfortable.
Not only security, but even media, too. Some of your people will be there. There is arrangement for media coverage because usually as things are going on there, reports come home and we are able to see our people at various points.
No, but for now, we are discouraging that. We are sending a team of media men, including NTA.
Yes.
We are sending them.
Yes.
But we don't want our coverage to have a wrong interpretation.
Well, since you say you have NTA among them, you have a guarantee of that, that your coverage will be of the highest standard and quality, the highest professional standard.
We have
nothing to worry about that, right?
Okay. We want a focus that will make everybody get into the spirit of what we are doing.
Certainly, you will get that as long as you say you have NTA on that. Get that. Let's go over to Kaduna now, and Yusuf is on the line from Kaduna. Hello, Yusuf. This will be just about our last caller tonight. Hello, Yusuf. Is Yusuf still there? Oh, dear. Hello? Well, I guess we'll have to go ahead without that call from Yusuf now. Well, at the start of the program, we talked about different holder sites. You even mentioned going over to Côte d'Ivoire, where you have certain sites and people who might want to go there. But we do also know that here in Nigeria, there's been some form of pilgrimage in somewhere around Abuja here, Dusa Alaji, for instance, which the Catholic Church in Abuja organizes yearly. Now, are there any plans to begin to establish certain places within this country for people who might want to go to for purposes of studying, a retreat, religious retreat, because in the long run, that's what pilgrimage is all about anyway.
Right. You know, one of the first goals we set is that in about 2-3 years, we are going to turn Nigeria into a global pilgrimage destination. And Nigeria is the best pilgrimage destination in the world, next to Israel. Especially Nigeria, because Nigeria has the most vibrant church in the world.
Nigeria has the best and most gifted ministers of the Word of God in the world. Nigeria is the only country today on earth where you can call a Christian meeting, you can have 4 or 5 million people gathered in one setting. And Nigeria is one of the most successful exponents of the Word of God and of church life in the world. And I tell you, the world needs to come and learn from Nigeria. We intend that in the next year, we're going to put together some of this information and we'll circulate them around the world. And we'll make arrangements where people around the world who have need for prayer, who have need for help, who have need for fellowship, who have need for different things, will come to Nigeria and locate where they need to go and go there. We intend to be a clearinghouse for that. And we're going to put those framework together because Nigeria qualifies for every spiritual. There's no city in this country where a great move of God is not going on. Every place. And we intend to maximize it and let the world see it.
Okay, let's, as we begin to wind down, have a brief recap of what pilgrims are supposed to be equipped with as they prepare for pilgrimage, and we turn to the head of mobilization of the NCPC, Sunday Uday, as they begin to prepare, even from the point of conception, from the point where you begin to think, well, maybe I'd like to go on pilgrimage. What do you begin to do? How do you prepare yourself for the pilgrims, those who have been cleared, who've paid? Let's just have a recap of the preparations.
Okay. Thank you very much. Sunny Uday, I'm also someone who have benefited immensely from pilgrimage. And it came from having an outlook. What am I looking for? My testimony is that I was married for 4 years. I didn't have a child. I know some people have waited for more, but I'm talking about my own experience. I went for pilgrimage the first time, 2008. The first thing that came to me was that Bible is true. The second time I went with my wife. And we came back a year after we had my son, Joseph, who is 7 years now. The first thing a Christian should do when you think about pilgrimage is, what are you looking for? What do you want? In what area of your life do you want God to intervene? Like you said, pilgrimage is a retreat. It's a time away from all the vagaries of life. Let me find my comfort. Let me go there and be with him. Because I tell you, there are some people who go on pilgrimage and come back with nothing. But I thank God that has not been my own case. I've come back with testimonies. Like I said, my son is just 7 years old. That's number one. So have an expectation. Have a yearning to encounter this Christ. So that you will not just come and be carried away. That even if you begin to encounter what God wants you to encounter, you will not even know. So have an expectation. Number two, as you prepare for pilgrimage, the next thing you need to have at the back of your mind is that we will educate you. This is the weather situation in Israel at this time. These are the things you need to have. These are the things you need to know. This is the way they feed. Mind you, some of the people who go on pilgrimage are just leaving their villages for the first time, and here they are going abroad. We'll teach them about the food, culture, teach them about, because we've had incidences that somebody finished eating food, will pack like 5 apples and put it in their bag, then things like that. But by constant education, that trend is reducing. I remember that first time I went to pilgrimage, 2008, we ate in a particular restaurant with everybody else. By the time we came back in the evening, they say, Nigeria, that side. Nigeria, that side. Why? Attitude. You know, black people were generally loud people. So we began to teach people on manners. Some people teach them how you need to dress when you're coming down for dinner or even for breakfast. Because, I mean, in my natural home, in my village, I could come out on a wrapper. I could wear my shirt or my trouser without a shirt. It's not a problem in the community. But when you move outside, you know, cultural differences. So we begin to enlighten them on things like that. This is the way to behave. This is the way to relate. This is the things to expect. Like my ear said, pilgrimage is coming to a point where one of my teachers will say, we'll cook you first. Prepare you like a meal that's going to be served to the outside world before you step out. So now we have started doing that gradually. Like you said, the security program we had, the first time we're having it in NCPC. I've been in NCPC for 5 years, so I can tell. Okay? So we prepare them, the weather, the attitude, the expectations, and also in the buying. Let me correct one impression when we're talking about abscondment. Sometimes we have had the issue of people saying people have absconded. Sometimes our people get to Israel, somebody fall ill. They take the person for medical treatment. For fear of that, the official might not allow them to go. They won't tell you. They will just sneak away, not knowing that this flight will leave tomorrow. And the flight that carries the capacity of about 350, 370, depending on the aircraft we're using, you don't know that these people come. People have, it's filled up. So by the next day, they come and they say, there's no flight going to Nigeria. They say, no, pilgrim. I was telling you, no, because there's no seats. But it's already reported that people have absconded. Only for us, maybe by interaction, we begin to know so-and-so person has gone to the embassy to report, and then eventually we will drop some staff who might be there or plead with somebody and say, please, can you allow this person to come back? Within which time, the press, they are gone. Nobody knew that, you know, the people are already back. We had that challenge with Plateau and Niger, you know, at the time, so they came back. So in preparing for pilgrimage, the first thing, prepare for an encounter. The Ethiopian eunuch, who's a black man like you and I, prepared for an encounter. When Philip came, it was easy. The moment it was explained to him, as a sheep being led to be slaughtered, he uttered no word. He was learning humility. He's the treasurer. He's like a CBN governor to the queen. But at the time, humility was taught him. So when you're going on pilgrimage, you go to so many sites. What is it you're looking for? If you don't have an expectation, you can still go and you come back this time. Somebody will be saying, it's a jamboree. For me, it has never been a jamboree.
All right.
It has been a special exercise.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Reverend Sam Ogbodo, Senior Pastor, King's Palace, as we round off your comments, final comments.
Just like I said, going to Israel or for pilgrimage, like on an encounter, or bringing the Bible to real life. Real life experience. You know, all of those things, like a child who go through school, secondary school, university, they are taught theory. I now graduate to practice. Mm-hmm. So after reading the Bible, you go to where they say, this is Rome, this is Israel, this is where Jesus was buried, these are the places you walk. Putting your feet on where Jesus walked is an experience.
Mm-hmm.
And if you go without expectation, there's no how you come back and remain the same, because Jesus is the Son of God. Israel is the place where he walked the streets on the planet Earth. So going to put your feet on where Jesus put his feet, going to sit on where he sat, going to the same Sea of Galilee where he performed miracle, is nothing like as a pastor, it strengthens your faith. If you're going to Israel, it's not a word of boosting my faith to believe God for the impossibility.
Amen.
So I encourage every Christian, every child of God who is healthy and alive to go to Israel before you go to heaven.
Amen.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, thank you. I remember that when I first went to Israel, I had a major experience at St. Peter's Church, Little Galikantu.
That's mine too.
When I got there,
yes.
There was this picture of Peter by a lady denying the Lord, denying him. And that's the first thing you see at St. Peter's. Then when you enter inside the church, then you will see Jesus talking to Peter after his resurrection and asking Peter, do you love me more than this? And there was restoration. And to me, that St. Peter's church gives the picture of what the entire encounter is all about, that we all deny Christ at times by our behavior, by the things we do, but then that his love, by the time you enter inside the church, you see Jesus restoring him to himself, that we have come here like people who have had some kind of denial of Christ. But the purpose of our being in the land of Israel is for us to be restored back to God. And this restoration gives us great joy. So that's a major encounter, and I want everybody who goes to encounter that.
All right. Final thoughts, Reverend Ujatu Uja.
You know, I want to first of all speak to every pilgrim who is flying with us this November and December. I want you to look out for a miracle of your life and trust that that miracle will translate into a miracle for our nation.
Amen.
And that you will be a major stakeholder and a leader and a game player in the future of this country. I believe, and we have set out, that every pilgrim who goes to pilgrimage should come back whole, come back with an experience, a life-changing experience that will be permanent and will live forever. Mm-hmm. And we want that, if possible, and I believe it's possible, every Christian should plan to go on pilgrimage. I tell you, get your Bible. Tony, they were saying what you need. Get your Bible and check it, because your understanding of the Bible may change when you go to Jerusalem, because there are some things you are misinterpreting because you didn't really know the place.
Yeah.
Right, this place story before I stop, that there was one preacher who opened his Bible and was teaching about Nebuchadnezzar. You know, Daniel said, Nebuchadnezzar. And he stopped, King Nebuchadnezzar. I preached and said, this man called Nebu, he had only a razor, but he used it to become a king. Now, he didn't know that that name is Nebuchadnezzar, you know. So there are many things in the Bible that you may be thinking is Nebu had a razor. But when you see them, it helps you give you a better interpretation and a better focus of the scripture. I want to become a pilgrimage and discover the scripture. Discover the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave us his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Mm-hmm. I want you to come and have a fresh encounter with Jesus Christ. You will have a story to tell.
Mm-hmm. Right. And it is on that note of hope we conclude this program. There'll still be so much more to talk about pilgrimage. We hope at some point in time we'll ask this gentleman, this reverend gentleman, to come back and explain more to us about the Christian pilgrimage. But for now, we'll have to leave it here. And I'd like to say a big thank you to Reverend Ujatu Uja, Executive Secretary of the NCPC. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate it.
Reverend Israel Akonji, Chairman of Christian Association of Nigeria, FCT. It's always a pleasure having you here.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And then thank you so much to Reverend Sam Ogbodo, Senior Pastor, King's Palace Church International, Kuji. Thank you for being here. And our thanks also to Mr. Sunday Ude, Head Mobilization of the NCPC. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
All right. And thank you also for being part of this program. Next week, we'll reach you again on NTA Tuesday Live. I'm Cyril Stover. Bye for now.